coming out tonight. I know that fishing or archery.
Hey, welcome back, Wildurban Adventures. This is part two of the Gary Yamamoto meet and greet. This is going to be a very long video, but if you look down here in the description box, this can be a timetable. So you can just click on the question and it'll take you directly to the question and answers. That way, so you don't have to watch the whole video. But if you feel like watching the whole video, please feel free to watch the whole video. I think it's full of wisdom and knowledge from Todd Huynh and Bass Fishing Hall of Famer Gary Yamamoto. So yeah, I think that this is a really great successful event, and I think that a lot of the youths, even the adults, it's gonna remember this for a long time, maybe even for the rest of their lives. So Gary Yamamoto is a very humble person. He's very funny as well, as you'll see in the video, and if you were there, you'll know that that he's a pretty funny guy. So but hopefully you guys are enjoying this whole event, for especially for the ones that were there. But you know what, I'm not gonna take up any more of your time. Let's get to the event, and as always, follow your dreams, follow your passions, make it happen. Let's go to the video.
Well, good evening, everybody. My name is Shane Rasmussen, and I am one of the coaches of the Centennial Fishing Team, and I just want to welcome everybody here. Appreciate you. I know there's football tonight, and there's a, you know, people head out of town in Minnesota. There's still some great fishing. In fact, the fishing is starting to get good, so I know all that. So it's really nice that you're here. We had just a tremendous opportunity to get a legend to come talk to us, and I know a lot of people worked really hard behind the scenes to make this happen, and a couple of them I want to introduce you to. So Saw, if you want to come out, and Lee. These two guys have worked really, really hard. In fact, a lot of these prizes that you see here tonight are, you know, a lot of their hard work. So, do you want to say anything?
Hey, thanks for coming out tonight. I know that fishing or archery openers tomorrow, and small game too for a lot of you guys. But then again, you know, we have a legend here, two legends actually, and so we're glad to have all of you out here. Hope you all have a good rest of the year, and there's still lots of fishing to do.
Hello, my name is Leif. I'm from Wild Urban Adventures YouTube channel. So it's an honor to see everyone here. It's also an honor to have Todd here and Gary Yamamoto and Sean. Without Sean to open up the school, we would not, or Shane, sorry, we would not be able to. We would not be able to have this event, and without all the sponsors, this wouldn't be possible. So without them, so yeah, thanks to them, and thanks to everyone for coming here today.
Well, I know you didn't come to listen to us talk, so we won't waste any more time. We'll get right to it. But it's my pleasure to introduce Todd Huynh. Todd is really the guy that kind of got this going for us, and I'll let him kind of say a few words and introduce you to the man himself. But Todd, thank you so much for everything you do.
All right, it's great to see everybody. You know, I grew up in Minnesota, and so I was in the seat one of you guys growing up, and it's really cool to come back and, you know, be in my country where I'm not getting stuff thrown at me wearing a Vikings hat, you know. And so really glad to see everybody here, and thank you for coming on a Friday night. And this kind of started off as a whim. You know, I've been very blessed with the relationship with Gary, and I just kind of asked him to come up here and fish a tournament with me. And he agreed to it, and we're like, man, I, you know, why don't we do something with a meet and greet for the kids, because Gary's never been up here, and to really get it together has been really cool, and I couldn't have done it without those two guys, and Shane for opening up this place. So let's give Shane a round of applause for him. You know, so we kind of wanted to do like a two-part for this. You know, the first part, I wanted to go through a couple things, and right before we do like a little question-answer with Gary, I get a lot of questions on like how to succeed in the pro staff game. Keeping off fishing on their boat, man, that's awesome. That's stuff that you guys will never ever forget in your lifetime. When you guys get to be like 40, 50, you guys are gonna remember those times. Just like I remember times when I went fishing with my dad. So you guys are the future of our sport. So please take that with responsibility. And so I want to share a couple things. So a lot of people ask me, how do you be successful in this pro staff game? How do I approach companies? How do I get sponsored? How do I get free stuff? How do I get discounted stuff? And I'll highlight a couple things. I won't make it too long. You know, the first thing is you got to go out and get it. Nobody's going to give you guys anything. Nobody knows who any of us are. We're not Kevin Van Dams. We're not Jacob Wheeler. We're not Brandon Pollock. We're nobody, right? And so I don't fish any professional circuit. And yet, you know, I'm able to sign out with some big companies. But it's not that way anymore. You know, companies are looking for your help to help pitch their product. All right, so nobody's gonna give you guys anything. You guys have to go out and get it. And so how do you go out and get it? The best way for you guys to get out your name to people is to go to shows. The Twin Cities Ice Show, all these fishing shows, the Bassmaster Classic, if you can get down there. All these shows, all these major marketing people, pro staff coordinators are gonna be at these shows. And it's the best time for you to introduce yourself and get your name to them. Say, I'm so-and-so, this is what I do, and you know, how can I be on the team? All right, that's the number one way to get on it. Nobody's gonna come out to you. You have to go get it, all right? And the first thing you wanna do when you approach these companies is you wanna be able to ask them how you can help them sell their product. It's not what you can get for free, right? I see that all the time when I work trade shows. These people come in and like, oh, how do I get free rods? How do I get free reels? How do I get free baits? You know how many people ask me how do I get free Yamamoto baits? Like, they just expect people to ship them baits, you know? You know, that's not the case. It's the wrong attitude. The right attitude is to come into these people and say, I want to help you sell baits. I want to help you promote your rods. I want to help you promote your reels. I want to promote you your clothing line. Right? That's what these companies are looking for. They're not looking for you to come in there and put your hands out and say, hey, what can you do for me? It's the opposite. What can you do for them? Right? And so that's a huge key, guys. So when you get these guys, remember what those key ingredients are. Number three is you're gonna get turned down, all right? And that's just facts, that's life. You're not gonna bat 1,000, you're not gonna get somebody to give you something right away. You're gonna fail, right? And how do we learn? By getting back up. And so when I first approached St. Croix, rods, they said no to me, and what did I do? I just said, all right, great, I'm gonna work harder. And so the next thing I always say is stay true to yourself. Like, I've always loved St. Croix rods. I've always used them. And so when they said no to me, I didn't go banging on the next door down or, you know, walk over to duck rod or whatever. I just kept using my St. Croix rods. I kept looking for, you know, St. Croix rod pro staffers that would sell me their rods at the end of the year for a discount, right? So then I kept kind of tracking my stuff. I kept, you know, promoting on my social media channels. I kept, you know, like, you know, going fishing and posting my pictures and, you know, loving my rods. And so the next year I saw them again at a show and they remembered me, and then I was able to showed up. Look, even though you guys said no to me, I still use your rods. I still love your rods. It's because that's who I am. So stay true to who, like, if you guys believe in a company, don't give up. You know, just because, you know, St. Croix or Daiwa or Shimano, they all said no to you, don't go chasing somebody else just because you want a badge on your jersey or something. Man, you know, go for it. If it's worth it, it'll come. Work hard and it'll come. So that's what I can share with you guys, you know, about these. Nobody's, like I said, you gotta go out and get it. And continue to share product. Get out there, go fishing, you know, tag their stuff. You know, another thing too is you know, social media is a mean game sometimes. A lot of haters, a lot of detractors. You know, don't let that deter you. You know, my suggestion is always take the high road. You know, there's a lot of different brands out there. You know, don't diss another brand just because you're with one. They're all good, right? And so, you know, your name is worth something. Keep it that way. And so, you know, don't disrespect another brand. Take the high road. Don't burn any bridges. Just because one guy says no to you, you know, he might be the pro staff coordinator at the next company next year. So it's a very small industry. Everybody knows each other. They all are friends. And so if you're blackballed, or you know, if you have a bad rep with one company, guess what? You're probably gonna get a bad reputation. So keep on the high road, be respectful, you know, work hard. And you know, just, you gotta get out there and fish. You know, what companies are looking for is somebody who's getting out there, getting on the water, fishing a lot, posting a lot of pictures with fish, and you know, so that's what they're looking for. You know, the power of social media is huge. You guys all know that. You guys are all in the generation of social media, and so it's a huge marketing idea for these guys, and they know it, and so they want to utilize you guys, but you guys know how to play the game, and so. So I want to keep it short. If you guys have any questions, feel free to hit me up. You know, I'll try to help you guys as much as can. We'll kind of focus now on Gary that you guys all came to see. But before that, I want to throw it over to Saul. We're going to give away a couple prizes. I'll continue through the evening. We were very, very fortunate that we've got awesome responses from, like, my sponsors and lots of Saw sponsors and companies around here like Shields and Blackfish and, you know, Shimano and St. Croix. I mean, it's just tons of pissy fun. Gave us some reels. And so it's a fun night. It's something to give back to all the kids. So, we want everybody to walk away with a chance to win some cool prizes, guys. So.
Yeah, so in order to go fishing, you need gear, right? So we're going to have somebody in the audience draw a ticket from here. Take out your tickets, young ones. He's gonna read out your ticket number, the last four.
9841.
Oh,
there we go.
All right. All right.
What's your name, buddy? All right, congratulations. What do you win?
Nice. Yep, so do not throw away your ticket after it. Even if you won once, you can still win the grand prize at the end.
Three grand prizes.
Three. All right, so we're going to do one more. Draw a ticket.
Yeah, we got got a lot of hats from signed by Kevin Van Dam and Jonathan Van Dam.
Woo!
You drawing more?
Sure.
Let's go. Let's give away some stuff.
Draw the ticket.
I like giving away stuff.
9836.
9836. We got it. All right, young lady in the front. All right, Max, how about one more? Feel really lucky. You know, he treats me like a nephew, and you know, he still teases me like a little kid sometimes, even though I'm 50 years old. But I'm very fortunate to be able to go fishing with him a lot, and you know, I get a lot of story time with him, and those are some of the times I really enjoy. Like, I soak it up like a sponge to hear like how the bait company started, how the senko started. So I'm gonna give you guys a little taste of that. So I'm going to give him some questions, and he can answer you guys. Let's give Gary a round of applause for being here. So Gary, I know you got a lot of stories. All right. So where do we start off? Like, how did your like passion of fishing start, Gary?
Well, you know, let me say one thing. I was conned into coming up here. All he said was, "You want to go fishing with me?" I said, "Okay, yeah, let's go fishing." And then all of a sudden it comes, "Did you go to high school?" And then I don't know what's next, but you know, there's gonna be something. So anyway, I'm glad to see all of you out here. I've got a lot of stories, and one of the stories he wants me to tell you is that, how did I get so passionate into fishing? And, you know, I see the young people out here, and it's nice to see the ladies starting to fish more. The fifth child in the family, my younger sister is 13 years older than I am, and so we were a split family. My parents were from Japan, so they were immigrants from Japan, went to Hawaii to try to make a living, and by the time I was born, they had been in Hawaii for 20 years. Working hard, trying to make a living, raising four children, and my father was a mason contractor, so he was quite successful. But they needed some extra money to go back to Japan. And what they had decided was that they would go to the countryside and lease a piece of land and grow some taro. I don't know if you folks know what taro is, but that's what they make poi out of in Hawaii. And so they leased about 5 acres of land in the country, and every weekend the whole family would go there to work. And being that I was only 3 years old at that time, lived on this farm had some anthurium plants with potted plants. And so I turned over every one of those plants, and there was a worm underneath. So here I am, 3.5 years old, learning to catch my own bait and go fishing. And I'm telling you this story now, but you know, my mother would probably have been arrested today because she just let me go on. But in the city where we lived in Hawaii, above Waikiki Beach, she wouldn't even let me cross the street. But the country, nature, was all right to her. And I guess it was all right because I survived. I went fishing starting at about 3.5 years old. I caught fish, and that's what we had for dinner the next week. So hey, at 3.5 years of age, I was providing food for my family. But that just continued and just started there and just kept growing. And being that I lived, our main home was above Waikiki Beach. There was this all-white canal and the golf course. And I spent all my free time, like summer vacations, fishing and catching fish. And if we had any extras, my mother would sell it to the guy that brought groceries around the house. In Hawaii, they had a truck that came around and sold groceries. And so one day I had caught some mullet, and there was 13 pounds of mullet. And she sold those mullet to that man for $1 a pound, and this was 60 years ago. Today, I don't know what the inflation rate is, but there would have been a tremendous amount of money. But anyway, that was the first income I ever had from fishing. But I used it to buy more fishing there. So I had a love for fishing from the very start of my life. And where did all this bass fishing come from? That came from the fact that I went to college in Los Angeles. Some of the colors that I wanted in it. make me whatever color I want. Can you use 5,000 gloves? Well, I guess I was either foolish or smart. I bought 25,000 gloves. 5 different colors. And that's where I started my business. The only place I sold some of this grub was out in the East Coast. There was one distributor that bought some of my grubs for the smallmouth fishery. And then the other side of the country, West Coast, bought a few grubs. But being that I was Japanese and promoting fishing, bass fishing was just getting started in Japan. So the first 10 years of my business, nobody in the United States, or very few people in the United States, knew I even existed, because 90% of my products went to Japan. I promoted the fishing in Japan, started tournament fishing in Japan, and was doing most of my business in Japan. But then I saw that I was basically saturating the market. So I turned my attention to fishing Bassmasters and trying to promote out into the other 3/4 of the United States that I was not in. So that's how I started my business, and basically started off with a grub. Then maybe some of you don't even know what a hula grub is, but the hula grub was got real popular. And then the senko came quite a ways after that. The senko was the bait that I wanted, because I went down to Florida and fishing a tournament, people were using the sluggo. And I don't know, most of you might not even know what a sluggo is, but it was a stick bait that you would catch out there and jerk it like a jerk bait, and you'd get strikes. But the bait was so hard that you might catch 1 in 5. So I said, if I made it in my bait, I probably could catch the fish. So that's where the senko started. But before it got popular as a jerk bait and a fast moving bait, one of my employees at my tackle shop said, all you have to do is cast it out there to a bed and let it sink to the bottom, and the fish will come and eat it. I said, no, that can't be. So I was fishing a tournament, and I cast to a bed that I saw. Lo and behold, I missed the bed by about 5 feet. And this bass came out, ate it, and my dad could have said, you're not supposed to do that. Now, some of you ladies back here, if you're the backseater, you probably throw the senko out there in the back and just read your book or just kept the line in the water and caught some fish. The senko is a funny bait. You don't have to work it very much. You don't have to move it. You don't have to jerk it around. Just by it falling down by itself, you get strikes. I used to guide in Mexico, and I had a husband and wife come down from Japan. They just got married. This was their honeymoon trip, so I don't know what the wife was thinking about. She couldn't fish, she couldn't cast or anything. So my wife was babysitting her. Letting the senko out with some line, and I was dragging the the husband was taking the boat fast up along the bank, casting to every spot that he thought there was fish. He caught a lot of fish, but they were all 2 pounds or less. She was dragging the senko in the bank, caught 7, 5, all the big fish that they caught in the 2 days they were with me was caught by the lady. because she wasn't doing anything to the senko. She didn't break them up. Some of you folks have experienced that. You don't have to do anything. You have to let up the phone. Or you're fishing a boat out, you cast two boats out, and you let it fall. And the reason for that is that senko, as it falls, it's twisting and it's doing its own thing. Because it saw, and the secret to my bait is the formulation. I don't use the same plastics that some of the other companies are using. And so it's got a different action. But anyway, that's the story of the senko. That's why probably if you fish my bait, you have thrown the senko.
Who's throwing a senko in here? I'm
wondering if they're fish.
Alright, let's get away some more prizes here. So we're gonna have more people draw from the crowd. We'll start over here. Got one ticket. 9828. 9828. More goodies. There's a lot of goodies, lots of prizes.
I had no reply. So Any other questions? Right there.
What's your favorite way to fish in a tournament as far as bed fishing or dock fishing?
Well, you're back to senko again. I have been using senko with a Texas rigging or, well, Texas rigging mostly. And one of the hooks that I like is I think it's owner that thinks with the screw lock, takes the screw lock worm hook. And I like to throw that. But one trick that I have learned over, I have developed in the year, that you can put a weight inside the senko, and some manufacturers have designed tungsten weights that you can stick into the bed, and they charge you a pretty penny for it. I got some secrets that as long as the other manufacturers are not here, I'll tell you why. One of the cheapest things to do is to get solder. Get you solder, wire together, get the biggest solder, and get yourself a good diagonal or a good cutting liner, and you can cut the senko square on one side and on the other side, cut it at an angle so you get a point, so you can push the point into the senko. And if you're careful, you can put it right in the middle and cast senko and it will sink. It's a lot better than, no, I better not say that. It's a way to do weighted senko. I guess there's, and in the last few years, popularity of the wacky senko has increased considerably. I used to always Texas rig it one end or the other, and I do a lot of wacky now, but with the lead weight or the solder weight in the fat side. And I have one more secret, but I'll wait to tell you that later.
All right. Any other questions? Take it right in the center, right there. What you got?
What's your favorite rod?
You know, unfortunately, you folks are a little too young that you don't know that I built my own custom rods. And let's see, it was more about 30 years ago I built a set of rods, and that's basically what I use.
I'm lucky to have one of those rods in my house, not coming out of plastic. Like a collectible. Alright, let's give some more prizes away. We got tons of prizes, man. Let's give one away to these kids. Got tons of stuff.
Next one is going to be from a gift card for Funk Buster Bees, $50 gift card. There's also another towel from Minnesota Pike Fishing Association and some more cigar lines by Brandon Borgarden.
9822. All right, here we go, front row. giving away.
What's the rod?
9, 8, 6, 7
Yeah.
9, 8, 6, 7
Yeah. Didn't want to come off. One more, right?
All right.
One more rod?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. You got a bunch of them. Can't take them home.
9, 8, 5, 2
9.
All right, we got this little guy over here. Come on down, buddy. What's your name, bud? Who else got some more questions about that little guy right there in the Nike? What you got, bud?
What's your biggest battle?
What's your biggest bat? Another chance for you to brag. He loves to brag this one on me.
Yeah, he hasn't even been close to this week. But I told you that I was guiding in Mexico, and I used to go down every winter to Lake Baccarat. And that was one of the prime lakes in the world, I would think. And I caught a 15-pound one out of there. I did catch a bigger one.
I told you. What other questions we got? Come on, gentlemen. Now, what's up, Tom? What you got, Tom?
Tom, what's your biggest fish? Your biggest bass?
Not that. My biggest bass is 8.5 pounds for largemouth and 6.25 for a smallmouth.
So.
I didn't want to answer that. You see that? I hear that all the time from him. What other questions we got? Right there. Yep, you.
No, I haven't been down to Mexico for a long time, so I don't fish back or anything. That used to be one of my fun lakes because I'd spend the whole winter down there guiding fishermen from Japan and even from the United States. But I think I like Lake Champlain in New York. That I held the record for the largest weight, a one-day weight, on Lake Champlain a few years back, and that was largemouth. But now we've got a lot of smallmouth there that even beating my record there. So I think Lake Champlain is one of my primary or favorite places. But maybe there's some lakes around here that I can do better.
All right. Well, one more question before we get to prizes.
Both of you, or Gary, how do you prepare for a tournament? So these guys are just getting tournament fishing, but what do you think are some of the keys to prepare for a tournament?
You know, some of the things that are happening today is that some of the younger fishermen have gotten very, let's say, knowledgeable on the electronics and what have you. And I'm too doggone old to learn all that electronic stuff. But from what I'm hearing is that they're out there practicing for a whole month. So fishing and trying to develop areas, that's probably the most important thing. But you folks can't be in at the lake for a whole month. You got to go to school. But like I told you before, develop your own technique, whether you fish a senko or a crankbait or a spinnerbait or a wiggle worm or whatever you do, develop your own style and keep at it. You know, I'm selling plastic. Well, I used to sell plastic. I sold the business, so I don't sell nothing anymore. But it was all plastic bait, and I primarily fish that. Our baits. But you have to develop your own style. You know, whether you like to fish boat up, or whether you like to fish outside the compass, or whatever, develop your own style of fishing. And remember one thing, bass like to stay close to the coast.
Yeah, Gary makes a great point. You know, that's something that I try to do too. You know, we watch a lot of videos, and there's, you know, so much on streaming and YouTube and all that stuff, and education-wise. You don't want to be the guy, you don't want to try to be somebody you're not. You know, if you're not a Kevin Van Dam, you're not going to be really good at the jerkbait. But, you know, if you're a finesse guy, or vice versa, if you're a power fisherman, which I know a lot of friends, our power guys, they love to throw moving baits. And, you know, I'm more of a finesse guy. I'm a smallie know, I love the drop shot. It's just, you know, there's a time and place for the jerkbait, but, you know, so kind of, you know, figure out what kind of type of fisherman you are and then kind of, you know, hone in on that and like, you know, get better at that instead of trying to get better at everything. Try to, you know, if you're a finesse fisherman, then kind of work on that and put that as your strength. And that goes a long way for, like, fishing tournaments, you know, practicing and just trying to develop your own style. All right, let's get some gifts away. We got a bunch of bags still up here.
All right, next litter is 9847. 9847.
Pete, what do we got in there, bro? Same thing? What's the same thing? Okay, any inside hats, lines, and a cigar. All right, next one.
9806.
Nobody? All right, little man. How about one more? You got a lot of rods still, don't we? Let's give away a rod. You see, you just chuck the rod in the crowd.
You know,
I regret a few things. I've been racing co-PB for the last 25 years, and I probably lost $500,000 a year for the last 25 years. And when I think back now, if I had opened one hamburger restaurant, I wouldn't be sitting here, I'd be flying around the world. I have one of the largest herds of Wagyu cattle in this country, and the only thing that I produce is Kobe beef that's 100% Wagyu. And I ruined about 5 people's lives tonight because I brought some hamburger up and they cut the hamburger and ate it. Now they can't eat any other hamburger. So, you know, the thing that sometimes I think back, I've been successful in the fishing industry, but the fishing industry has raised these cattle and spent a whole lot of money. I lost a lot of money by just raising them and trying to sell the meat. If I had opened one hamburger restaurant, it would have been 20 or 30 hamburger restaurants today. And I would have been flying around the world without any careful expenses. But the Wagyu cattle has tremendous opportunity. That's the only beef in this country that has unsaturated fat. So you can eat as much of that juicy, fatty, saving for fatty hamburger as you want. Not even worry about it. And maybe 90% of people here don't even know that. And so I got into it, the cattle business, to try to say, hey, if I raise these animals, maybe I can help the United States. And I still think I will. But I could have been a billionaire today if I had opened one hamburger. And then I can do that today still and probably be successful, but I'm too tired. So if you want to open a hamburger restaurant, come and see me.
I'm going to have to disagree with him because even if he had $1 billion, nothing would change about him. And I'll tell you guys a good story. We were down at his ranch in Texas, and this was before he sold his company, and we were just talking, going fishing on his ranch, and we're in this like old golf cart from like 1963. And this thing's like bouncing around the ranch, and, you know, and he's like telling me he's going to sell the company, and I go, you sell the company, can you get a new cart? You know, like, this thing is like, seriously, it's like $200 or something like it. It's like old. And so then when he sold the company, I came back to visit him this year, and I go, why is the golf cart still here? Where's that brand new UTV or something? And then he didn't say nothing. Then I went inside the house, and his wife bought him a brand new UTV. So, see, nothing would, even if he had $1 billion, nothing would change about him. Any other questions? Right here in the front row.
What's your favorite time of the day to go fishing?
Well, basically any time. But there are times, as goes along normally, where there's the moon, the tidal condition, or whatever, the fish might be more active. And, you know, the little bit of breeze comes up and they become active. So there are times when I guess you need to figure that out for yourself because I can't.
People think his ranch is full of just bass, but he's got these like alien bluegills that are about like this big. They look like aliens. You guys think you guys got some big bluegills up in Minnesota? Wait till you see these bluegills. They're like, they look like bass. You got a big old head. And so he feeds them, no wonder they get so big. I got a question for you, Gary. Do you enjoy freshwater fishing or saltwater fishing more now?
I guess fishing is fishing, it doesn't matter. You know, when you think about fishing and saying that, hey, if I go out in the ocean, I might catch a 20-pound red snapper or a 130-pound yellowfin tuna or a 6-inch white trout. I enjoy the 6-inch white trout as much as the 130-pound tuna. It took me so long to get up that he almost killed me. You know?
All right, how about another question before you give away some prize? You've already answered something. We'll come back to the top. How about right there in the back?
What's the one fish that he lost that you felt great about?
Don't tell him the red snapper. Don't tell them about the red snapper.
You know, that's a question I can't even answer. When you're fishing, you lose and fish all the time. And whether that was a monster or a little guy that was just a tough fish, you never know. And so, it's a hard question to answer. You always catch fish. Sometimes you hook onto a bass and you say, hey, this is a prime bass. But he was just a strong, little, smallmouth instead of a fly bass. So there's really no answer to that that I can give.
He had a red snapper hooked on a couple weeks ago. We were down the hall fishing. And I think he unbuttoned the hook with his hook set or something. But I went to net it. Thing went, got away, and for 3 days he wouldn't let it go. Then I lost his red snapper. 3 days, I heard about it. Right here.
How do you recover from not doing so well in a tournament?
Well, you're expecting to do well all the time. You mistaken for first place, but. You just go fishing and try to figure out, did you set the hook too hard, or did you set the hook too quickly, or are you using a senko and did you give him enough time to eat it, right? Probably, if you set the hook and you missed it, you set the hook too soon, if it's a senko. Because he'll swallow it down and you gotta get the hook out of his gut. Basically, what I say is that any of my baits with a lot of salt in it and texture of it, don't set the hook too quickly. He's going to hold it, and he's going to try to eat it. And if you miss him, that's your fault.
You know, one of the things I learned from Gary about the bait is, you know, I used to throw a lot of weighted Texas style. I'm a guy that wants to get my bait down real fast. And one of the first times I fished with Gary looked at me and goes, why are you in a hurry to get the bait down? Are they all on the bottom of the lake? And, you know, that's something that he taught me that I'll always remember. It's like, why are we in a hurry to put that bait down on the bottom, right? Let that bait flutter down the way he designed it to flutter down with his combination of, you know, what's consistency in the plastic. So that's something for you guys. Just be patient. You know, like let the bait do the work instead of, you know, wanting it to you know, being impatient and putting down at the bottom so fast with the biggest weight we can find. All right, let's give away some prizes. We got a bunch of prizes. What we got? What we got over there, Lee?
We got two more shields, tackle box, some more sign hats.
Sign hats, tackle boxes.
And a lower than each.
All right, we're giving away two bags.
9840.
9840. Questions? Any other questions? Right here in the front.
You got a traveling the nation throughout your years, for all the guys that drive trucks, what truck was the most reliable for you? What make and model?
Well, you know, the thing is, when I was actually working at the plant, I had a Dodge one ton dually that I used to drive from Page, Arizona to Los Angeles every week. And I would take the cargo that was flying to Japan to my bait company in Japan, and then turn around and pick up supplies and drive back. So I drove that Dodge dually for years. Then Ford came out with the Ford Excursion with the diesel engine. I still have two of those with 300,000 miles on it. But in the last few years, I've been driving the Toyota Tundra, and that's a nice car. Except the dents that I have on it now.
All right, more prizes. What do we got? We'll take questions. We'll take some more questions after the scoreboard. Hey, I want those Blackfish gift certificates. Where are those at?
Woo!
Let's give some of those, baby. How about, who's got them? Are they in the bag?
In the truck.
They're not in the truck. What? He's trying to save them for himself. That's it. I got you, Max. Can we send somebody out in the truck to get one?
I don't have the keys.
We can do the head trunk
after this one.
Alright, let's go. Let's give away a couple prizes. I'm trying to give away good stuff, guys. These guys won't let me.
9813. 9813.
Fishing rod. What do we got? Alright. Long college prep team. Let's give away another rod.
9816.
9816.
Woo!
I know, they're winning all the prizes. Right here, we got all these rods over here. How about one more? How about a bag? Bag of goodies. I know there's some cigar line in there.
Good
value right here. 9845. All right, got a winner. All right, let's take a couple more questions while we get these Blackfish gifts that she gets in the car. No worries. How about right there, gentleman in the black with the hat, right there, raise your hand. Yep.
What line do you throw your senkos on?
What line do you throw your senkos on?
You know, that's a good question. And what I use is, I don't know if you've seen it or not, but it's called YGK. It's a braided line. And I started using that about 10 years ago. And it's one of the finest braided lines that there are. And the other thing that I attach to that is a 16-pound to 20-pound fluorocarbon line. And for any of you who are using less than 16-pound test line, you're not a bass fisherman. If you're a bluegill fisherman, anything less than 16 might be all right, but bass is great. Some of the lines, my best buddy took second in the tournament, lost, I don't know, $20,000 or whatever it was, because he had 8-pound test line on his reel instead of 16. Well, that's the other story I can tell you. I went back to Japan in 1996 and I bought some fluorocarbon line. And I bought some 20-pound test and some 16-pound test and brought it back. And I fished the tournament at Lake Mead, casting to crystal clear water. Use the 16 Tony Pontes on and dropping my 1 ounce football head on ledges. That year I won the tournament. So from then on, I did some studies on fluorocarbon line, and fluorocarbon line disappears in water. We took photographs of all the different sizes of line and what have you, and you could not see a fluorocarbon line. So there's no reason to be using 8 to 10 pound test line, or even 12 pound test line. So I hope this helps some of you folks not losing that big fish that you might need for top prize or to make a check.
I put 15 pound fluorocarbon light in my boat just for him this week. He's not going to touch my 8 pound. Any other questions?
Nice. 9885.
9885.
couple more questions and we'll do a couple more prizes. All right, are you going to front little guy right there? What you got, bud? Yeah, you. What's it? I can't hear you.
Fish what?
Oh, what's your favorite fish to eat? You asking him or me?
Oh, that's pretty hard, but I play with the saltwater fish and the trout, speckled trout and white trout. I process them. I fillet them out and then I'll season them. And then I'll bread them, and then I freeze them. And I give that away to a lot of people, and they all enjoy it. I really enjoy that too, but fish is fish, you know. There's some things like a snapper with, some of you might not like raw fish, but I know Todd and I love the sashimi, raw fish, and poke, and a lot of other things. So it all depends on what you desire tonight, whether it's a fried fish or a raw fish or a seasoned fish, or, you know, and even there's so many ways of preparing, like the Oriental Japanese will put it in soy sauce and steam it, and it's very good too. So it not one favorite, I guess. I like fish and I like seafood. I like crabs, so we eat anything, I guess.
He does love anything. I guess for me, is I like perch for freshwater, and if I say bass, everybody can jump on me. No, I prefer saltwater fish when it comes to eating. When you know, one of things. When I come down there, I enjoy like eating the fish almost as much as catching it with Gary. You know, we'll do it in like sashimi style. We'll do poke, and you know, he'll cook it in this like teriyaki sauce. So you know, eating down at Gary's place is almost as good as going fishing with Gary. So he loves to eat fish. Any other questions? Right in front here.
Is there a favorite lake in California that you and Gary like to fish?
Favorite lake in California?
I've been in California for probably 50 years now. When I lived in California, I wasn't really a bass fisherman, but I fished the Delta and fishing tournaments there, which is an exciting place. You might catch a salmon instead of a bass, but you know, there's all kinds of fish there. I would say if I was in California, the Delta was probably my favorite place.
I have to push California a lot. I want to go to Delta and like Clear Lake, Delta. If I were to go to California, I would fish those two lakes. I fish Diamond Valley down in the southern end. It's good, but nothing like UC stories of like the Delta. So if I go to California, that's where. But if you had to give me like my favorite place to fish, I would say it's like St. Lawrence River. I think that's just the most amazing fishery in the world right now. And when you guys watch tournaments in the St. Lawrence River, the amount of big fish in there is tremendous. And you know, I'm lucky enough to call Sturgeon Bay like my home lake, and I fish it a lot. And you know, Zach lives 30 minutes south of Sturgeon, and we fish together a lot. And it's amazing. A lot of big smallmouth, but St. Lawrence River is just on another level. I'm curious in here. Let's play a little. I'm curious to see if you prefer smallmouth or largemouth fishing. I'm curious to see what, you know, we always have this like fun game. I'm a smallie guy. Who enjoys largemouth fishing more in this room? All right. And who enjoys smallmouth fishing more? All right. Let's see. It's actually closer than I thought. So, for the guys that are largemouth, I don't know what you guys are talking about. Go catch some 5-pound smallmouth. You'll change your mind. 5-pound smallmouth in open water in 8-pound fluorocarbon leader.
Not 15, but then y'all know. Lady right there.
So, starting a business obviously must have taken a ton of your time. How did you find time when you were actively growing the business to also go fishing?
You know, you're right. I didn't go fishing. I used to inject the plastic in the daytime and take it home at night and sit by the television plucking the baits off the strings and for packaging them and, you know, basically did everything myself. To see now 100 employees in a room packaging those things that I used to do in my bedroom is something to see. And in order to keep up with the sales of senko that people's been buying, I spent $2 million on two packaging machines. And now, with 17 or 18 employees, they can do the work of 3 days. The 50 employees used to do in 3 days. So that really has helped. But to see the growth is just something that it's hard to believe.
It's a good lesson for you kids out there. There's, you know, look at Gary, the success story that he's had. You know, from fishing as a kid to the best bait company in the world. And, you know, it's all hard work. There's no shortcuts. And so that's like everything in life for you kids. You know, education, you know, hard work, and it's all the, you know, ingredients of a successful recipe. So, you know, Gary didn't get successful overnight. You know, most all businesses don't. So you guys gotta put your time in it, work hard, and, you know, keep aiming for your goals. And you know, that's how to be successful. You guys, look at the guy here, it's the most successful bait business in the world, and, you know, he's given you the recipe. So you guys, you know, it's something that you guys can learn. Other questions? All the way in the back.
Riley, go ahead.
You got it, Riley.
What's the biggest fish you've ever caught?
Do we have to hear this again from him? Okay, say it again, Gary.
The biggest fish.
Biggest fish.
I caught 185 pounds. Yellowfin tuna. And it took 4 hours to bring him up. He's got a video of what I use as like what I call a special technique, and maybe we need to have him run it again so you can see it.
Any other questions? I could share that with you guys. Like, and he's got some stuff here that we'll have some time at the end where he can show you guys different ways to rig it. You know, when I picked him up from the airport this morning, he had like, you know, a box, and it was like, I thought it was like baits and stuff, but it was like Wagyu burgers that he brought to the shop. And so, and then he brought a bunch of senkos, and I looked at him and I go, are you kidding me? Like, people who fished in my boat know that my boat is half loaded with senkos. Like, you don't need to bring all that. But he's got his special senkos, I guess. So we'll see if it works tomorrow and we'll ask something Monday. Any questions? Front here, what you got?
your favorite reel?
What's your favorite reel?
I guess I've been using Ishimamoto all my career. And you take the Ishimamoto spinning reel and use it in salt water for 30 years and it still works. I think it's a pretty good reel. And the other reels that I use with dive, that's good reel too. And then with a special reel for deep sea fishing, that deep common thing's nice, so that's from dive.
I've never seen one of these reels. We were down saltwater fishing and he brought out this reel that was about this big and it had like a digital counter on it. It was like electronics and, you know, we were watching the monitor, you know, where the spools of the red snapper were in the water column. And then we were dropping right to them and it was cool. And then they told me there's a reel that I guess you can hit a button that reels it back up to. And I'm like, where's the fun in that? Right? So, I don't know. But I didn't pay him to say Shimano, or I can use a Shimano. One more question before we do the last prizes. Right here at the front, what you got?
So my question for you is, do you enjoy doing other hobbies besides fishing when you're younger?
You have other hobbies?
I don't think I have other hobbies except trying to keep the boat in line, trying to fix the trolling motors, trying to any business that you run, if you have to call on someone to do everything for you, you're not going to be successful. You have to be capable of preparing things that you need to prepare, have knowledge of all the things that you are involved with. So, yeah, fishing is a sport that I like, but I have to keep my bass boat in shape, my motorhome in shape, my trucks running, and all those things come into play. It's not just going fishing and coming back. So be aware of everything around you. It's not just one thing. Whether it's fishing or anything else you do, you gotta be aware of everything around you.
I think cleaning fish is his hobby. It's what he loves to do down in salt water. He just cleans all day. All right, let's give away the last of these prizes, boys.
So for the last four prizes, I'm putting back all the tickets that have been drawn already in the box. So you get a second chance to win one of these prizes up here.
All right, what do we got first?
First, we got two more still brown with a pick up on here.
Nice.
And then we'll go to the two grand prize that we got.
All right.
All right. 9847.
9847. All righty. What's your name, buddy?
Cal.
Cal? Yeah. What high school are you from?
White Bear.
White Bear.
Woo!
Good job.
Did you go to Nationals?
He went to Nationals.
Oh, you went to Nationals?
Yeah.
Yeah, let's give this guy a hand. Woo! Yeah. You're representing this moment. 9866. This one right here, this little kid? Yeah! What's your name, bud?
Oliver.
Oliver, how old are you, Oliver? Nine. Congratulations, Oliver. All right, who we got?
First of the second
gen
prize right here.
Woo!
So
a
kayak,
and then
here
is
a Hickson hat, there's another 50-pound reel, a lot of goodies in here.
I like that bag.
Some more Minnesota Fire Fishing Association towels, rock sleeves,
Nice.
There's reels, there's cedar lines, there's a
jigs.
What's that?
Rod holder?
So yeah, this is probably at $200-$250 or more. So.
Nice. What we got? Winner is?
9859.
9859. Yes! Yeah! I love it. Grab this young lady. Come on up, young lady. What's your name? Alyssa. How old are you, Alyssa?
8.
And what do you like to fish for, Alyssa?
Bass.
Let's give Alyssa a hand. All right, and the last grand prize we got is a rod that I got St. Croix to give us. It's a brand new Legend tournament. It's a brand new line that just came out. It's I believe it's like a $340 rod. So, what is it, a 7.4 heavy fast?
Yeah,
7.4 heavy fast, perfect for jigs or, you know, throwing a frog even. All right, who's the lucky one? Somebody's walking away with some. Who's the lucky one, bud?
9822.
9822! Yes! 19! What's your name, bud?
Marcus.
Marcus, how old are you?
15.
Are you on a fishing team?
No.
No? What do you like to fish for? Anything that bites?
Huh?
Anything that bites?
Yeah.
All right. You know, let's have a couple more. Let's do like two more questions, and then I just wanted to give some time. I know some people took some pictures with Gary earlier, but I want to give some time for you guys. Gary has a bunch of cards signed up here. You guys want him to sign like a bag of senko or your shirt or something, you guys are more than welcome to come up here, form a line, and I'm making it work. We got a little bit of time. Relax. No. We got to work here. You think this is a free vacation? So we'll do it real quick, but let's take two more questions. Anybody want to ask? Gary, right here to the right.
The question I wanted to ask is, for all the young anglers that want to get to bass fishing, whether it's a fun or tournament fishing, tentative fishing, to get up in the morning, do that for consecutive days with a sport day here, what advice would you give the young anglers so they can be successful when they wake up and they go fishing for the day?
These kids grow up, they wake up and go fishing early in the morning. What advice can you give them to kind of push them to keep going?
You know, it's pretty hard to push them on.
Thank you. One last question.
Come on, Ranger.
Young man.
If you're out on the boat all day, what boat snack do you bring?
What boat snack do you bring?
Normally, I bring a ham and cheese sandwich. But I had to take two. Because the puppies will eat half of one. I got two dogs. But yeah, I like ham and cheese sandwich, and I like some food, so whether it's grapes or cherries or whatever.
All right, let's give Gary a hand of applause.
You know, he told me, let's go fishing. He didn't tell me I had to sit here and talk to all the people for 3 hours. So maybe the next time he asks me to go fishing, I'm going to say, well, what? Kind of fishing. But thank you for coming. I enjoyed talking to you. And you know, this communication really puts emphasis on my life that people are interested in me. I was just a lowly fisherman and a campground, and now you think I'm famous, but all I did was my job.
Lee's here, we're soft. These guys work pretty really hard. And anglers, you gotta do this because these guys have talked about their passion, and you guys are living your passion right now, and you've gotta thank your parents, your boat captains, those people that are taking you out in the water. So you guys, give them a big round of applause. Guys, thanks for a great night. Thanks again, you guys. You're awesome.